Imagine being stung by a creature over 150 feet long, with countless venomous tentacles that glows blue in the darkness. Now imagine that this monster isn't a single animal, but a collection of clones that can't survive without each other. This isn't science fiction. It's the reality of the giant siphonophore, one of the ocean's most enigmatic and terrifying predators. At first glance, a giant siphonophore might be mistaken for a strange, elongated jellyfish, but these creatures are far more complex and intriguing than their gelatinous cousins. Siphonophores belong to the phylum Cnidaria, which includes jellyfish, corals, and sea anemones. However, they stand out as unique even among this diverse group. The giant siphonophore, scientifically known as Praia dubia, is not a single animal in the traditional sense. Instead, it's a colony composed of thousands of individual organisms called zooids. Each zooid is genetically identical but specialized for different functions within the colony. This level of specialization and cooperation is so advanced that many scientists consider the entire colony to be a single superorganism. These remarkable creatures can grow to astonishing lengths. While most siphonophores are relatively small, Praia dubia can stretch up to 160 feet long. That's longer than a blue whale. Yet despite this impressive length, the body of a giant siphonophore is surprisingly thin, often compared to the width of a broomstick. Living in the deep ocean, typically between 2,300 and 3,300 feet below the surface, giant siphonophores inhabit a world of near total darkness. They've adapted to this environment in fascinating ways, developing bioluminescent capabilities and intricate hunting strategies that we'll explore in more depth later. To truly understand giant siphonophores, we need to delve into their remarkable colonial structure. Imagine a city where each citizen is genetically identical, yet each has a specific job crucial to the survival of the whole. This is essentially how a siphonophore colony operates. The colony begins its life from a single fertilized egg, which develops into the first zooid. Through a process called budding, this initial zooid produces genetically identical clones, each of which specializes into a specific type of zooid with a unique function. These zooids are arranged along a central stem in a specific order, forming distinct regions of the colony. At the front of the colony is the pneumatophore, a gas-filled float that helps the siphonophore maintain its position in the water column. Behind this are the nectophores, which are essentially living jet engines that propel the colony through the water. These swimming zooids pulse rhythmically, working in perfect coordination to move the entire organism. The longest section of the colony is called the siphosome, which contains several types of specialized zooids. Some of these are equipped with long, stinging tentacles used for catching prey. Others are responsible for digesting food and distributing nutrients throughout the colony. There are also reproductive zooids that produce gametes for sexual reproduction. This level of specialization and cooperation is truly remarkable. No single zooid could survive on its own, yet together they form an organism capable of traversing vast distances, capturing prey, and reproducing. Giant siphonophores are formidable predators, employing a hunting strategy that's both passive and highly effective. Their method of capturing prey is a perfect example of how the different specialized zooids work together for the benefit of the entire colony. The hunting zooids are equipped with long, extendable tentacles covered in stinging cells called nematocysts. These tentacles can stretch out for several meters, creating a deadly curtain in the water. When prey, typically small fish, crustaceans, or other zooplankton, brushes against these tentacles, the nematocysts fire, injecting a powerful neurotoxin that paralyzes the unfortunate victim. But how do they attract prey in the pitch-black depths of the ocean? This is where bioluminescence comes into play. Many species of siphonophores, including Praia dubia, can produce their own light through a chemical reaction. They use this ability to create flashes of blue light along their tentacles, which can attract curious prey or mimic the movement of smaller bioluminescent organisms. Once prey is captured and paralyzed, the tentacle contracts, bringing the food to the gastrozoid's mouth. The gastrozoid then begins the process of digestion, breaking down the prey and distributing nutrients to the rest of the colony through a system of internal canals. This feeding strategy is remarkably efficient. By creating a large, almost invisible net of stinging tentacles, siphonophores can capture prey without expending much energy on active hunting. It's a perfect adaptation for life in the deep sea, where food can be scarce and energy conservation is crucial. One of the most captivating aspects of giant siphonophores is their ability to produce light, a phenomenon known as bioluminescence. In the eternal night of the deep ocean, this ability serves multiple crucial functions. The bioluminescent display of a giant siphonophore is truly a sight to behold. This isn't just a static display. Siphonophores can control their light production, creating patterns of flashes and pulses along their length. As mentioned earlier, one primary function of this light show is to attract prey. The moving lights can mimic the movement of smaller bioluminescent organisms, luring curious predators into the siphonophore's trap. But this isn't the only use for their living light. Bioluminescence also serves as a defense mechanism. When threatened, some siphonophores can detach parts of their body, leaving behind glowing pieces that continue to flash and move. This can distract or confuse predators, allowing the main body of the colony to escape. Furthermore, scientists believe that bioluminescence may play a role in communication between siphonophores, possibly for mating purposes. However, given the challenges of studying these delicate creatures in their natural habitat, much about their use of bioluminescence remains a mystery. The ability to produce light is not unique to siphonophores. It's estimated that up to 90% of creatures living in the open ocean can create some form of bioluminescence. However, the complex and controllable light displays of giant siphonophores make them stand out as true masters of this incredible adaptation. Giant siphonophores inhabit a realm of the ocean known as the mesopelagic zone, often referred to as the twilight zone. This region, typically between 200 and 1,000 meters deep, is characterized by its dim light, too dark for photosynthesis, but not pitch black like the abyssal depths below. Praia dubia specifically tends to live between 700 and 1,000 meters deep. At these depths, the pressure is intense, up to 100 times greater than at the surface, and temperatures hover just above freezing. Yet it's in this harsh environment that giant siphonophores thrive. These creatures have a surprisingly wide distribution. They've been found in oceans all around the world, from the icy waters near Iceland to the tropical seas off the coast of Chile. This broad range suggests that giant siphonophores are highly adaptable, capable of surviving in various oceanic conditions as long as they can maintain their preferred depth. The twilight zone is a critical part of the ocean ecosystem, serving as a highway for the largest animal migration on Earth. Every night, countless organisms rise from the depths to feed in the nutrient-rich surface waters, returning to the safety of the deep before dawn. Giant siphonophores play a crucial role in this ecosystem, both as predators and as prey for larger animals. However, this unique habitat is under threat. As climate change alters ocean temperatures and currents, and as human activities like deep sea mining become more prevalent, the delicate balance of the twilight zone could be disrupted. Understanding and protecting the habitat of creatures like the giant siphonophore is crucial for maintaining the health of our oceans. The reproductive strategies of giant siphonophores are as fascinating as their other characteristics. Remember, each siphonophore colony started as a single fertilized egg, But how does this complex organism reproduce? Siphonophores employ both asexual and sexual reproduction. The growth of the colony itself is an asexual process. As mentioned earlier, new zooids are created through budding from existing ones. This ensures that all zooids in a colony are genetically identical. They're essentially clones of each other. Sexual reproduction, on the other hand, involves specialized reproductive zooids called gonophores. These produce either sperm or eggs, which are released into the water. Fertilization occurs externally, with sperm from one colony fertilizing eggs from another. Interestingly, some siphonophore species are hermaphroditic, meaning a single colony can produce both male and female gametes. However, they typically can't self-fertilize. The sperm from one colony still needs to find eggs from a different colony. Once fertilization occurs, the resulting zygote develops into a tiny larva called a planula. This larva eventually settles and begins to develop into the first zooid of a new colony. From this point, the process of budding begins, and a new siphonophore colony is born. This combination of asexual and sexual reproduction allows siphonophores to reap the benefits of both strategies. Asexual reproduction allows for rapid growth and regeneration of the colony, while sexual reproduction introduces genetic diversity, which is crucial for the long-term survival and adaptability of the species. Despite their size and widespread distribution, giant siphonophores remain one of the least studied creatures in the ocean. This is due to several factors that make researching these animals exceptionally challenging. First and foremost is their habitat. The deep ocean is one of the least explored environments on Earth. It's difficult and expensive to send research vessels and equipment to the depths where giant siphonophores live. Even when we can reach these depths, the vastness of the ocean means that finding a specific siphonophore can be like looking for a needle in a haystack. Another major challenge is the fragility of these creatures. Giant siphonophores are incredibly delicate. Their bodies are held together by the intense pressure of the deep ocean. When brought to the surface, they quite literally fall apart. This makes it nearly impossible to capture specimens for study in labs or aquariums. Even observing them in their natural habitat is tricky. The lights and movements of submersibles or remotely operated vehicles can disturb or damage siphonophores. Many of our observations come from chance encounters during other deep sea research missions. Furthermore, the colonial nature of siphonophores presents unique challenges for genetic studies. Traditional methods of DNA barcoding, which are used to identify and classify species, can be confusing when applied to what is essentially a colony of clones. Despite these challenges, scientists are developing new methods to study these elusive creatures. Advances in deep-sea imaging technology, for example, are allowing us to capture clearer footage of siphonophores in their natural habitat without disturbing them. While we still have much to learn about giant siphonophores, it's clear that they play a significant role in deep-sea ecosystems. As both predators and prey, they form an important link in the ocean food web. As predators, siphonophores help control populations of smaller organisms like copepods and fish larvae. Their feeding habits influence the distribution and abundance of these smaller species, which in turn affects the entire ecosystem. On the other hand, siphonophores themselves serve as food for larger predators. Species like sea turtles, sunfish, and some types of whales are known to feed on siphonophores. In this way, siphonophores help transfer energy from the small organisms they consume to larger predators higher up the food chain. Siphonophores also play a role in the biological carbon pump, the process by which carbon is transported from the surface ocean to the deep sea. When siphonophores die, their bodies sink, carrying carbon to the ocean floor. Over time, this process helps sequester carbon in the deep ocean, playing a small but important part in regulating Earth's climate, Moreover, the bioluminescent capabilities of siphonophores contribute to the complex light environment of the twilight zone. This living light show influences the behavior of numerous other species, shaping the ecological interactions in this dim realm. As we face global challenges like climate change and ocean acidification, understanding the role of organisms like giant siphonophores becomes increasingly important. These creatures are not just fascinating in their own right, they're integral components of an ecosystem that covers more than half of our planet's surface. From their unique colonial structure to their bioluminescent displays and their crucial role in deep sea ecosystems, they challenge our understanding of what it means to be an individual organism. Yet for all we've learned, giant siphonophores remain shrouded in mystery. Each new discovery seems to raise more questions than it answers. How do the individual zooids coordinate their activities so perfectly? How long can a siphonophore colony live? How will climate change affect their distribution and abundance? These questions remind us of how much we still have to learn about our oceans. If this glimpse into the shocking realms of deep has you thirsting to uncover more hair-raising mysteries from our reality's darkest, most primordial frontiers, make sure to comment your thoughts, questions, and strangest theories below. And if you'd like to stay up to date on the more deep sea creatures, be sure to hit that subscribe button and turn on the notifications bell. Together, we can continue to unravel the mysteries of the deep, one bite at a time.